Second speaker, Johannes Kakai, research fellow at the Franz Rosenzweig Minerva Research Center at Hebrew University. And he's writing his PhD thesis on the adoption of permanent family names by Jews in Galicia and Bukovina. And we'll submit his thesis, hopefully this summer. We wish you success with that. But today, Switzerland, between Carpathians and Prut, Jewish family names in Bukovina. Please.
Thank you very much. You mentioned my dissertation, which I hope to finish soon. And this is a historical work, so I'm an historian, but every once in a while there are moments where I see that the historical sources that I usually use don't help me anymore, and I need other sources, in this case, etymology. So in my paper today, I want to highlight the importance of etymological analysis and observations and how this helped me in my historical work in overcoming a gap that could not be answered without with the historical sources alone. In my case study, Bukovina. Very little is known about the names of Jewish family, the history and etymology of Jewish family names in Bukovina, as they have never been the target of research. Originally a part of Ottoman-dominated Moldavia, Austria annexed the area in 1775 and implemented a military administration which lasted 12 years before Bukovina became part of Galicia, also part of Austria, in 1786. And this is the reason why I deal with Bukovina, because it has another totally different historic background than Galicia. Galicia was Polish, Bukovina Moldavian, but still, for 60 years, they shared the same history, same legislature, and so on. So, a year after this annexation, in 1787, the Galician authorities ordered the district officials in Bukovina to conduct a census of the Jewish population in order to assign permanent family names. That had happened already 2 years earlier in Galicia. This is why. The commission traveled across the district, Bukovina, and was surprised to learn that the Jews in Bukovina had already adopted permanent family names a year earlier under the military administration in 1786. So they assigned only new names to the families who did not already bear a family name. The problem is that we do not really know what happened in 1786. We know that there were two waves, 1787, 1786, but we do not have many sources about this first wave. And this is like my starting point for this research today. We do not have original name lists of either of both naming waves, and so we cannot clearly differentiate which names were created in which wave. Still, we have several lists which originated in the first 5 to 10 years after the name creation. With their help, I was able to trace about 500 family names which must have been created in 1786 and 1787. So let me start with a superficial analysis. First, we have to understand that family names were a matter of officially registered families. Therefore, in most cases, single women, like widows, as well as servants, did not receive a family name. They usually kept traditional patronymics, sometimes even for decades. In contrast, among the nearly 500 family names that I found, there are almost no traces of these traditional patronymics or names derived from personal names. We find we have also some animal names, but we are not always sure, we cannot always be sure if they are really referring to personal names. We find one Kohen, one Kahanan, no Levi, or any other common derivatives of these names. Only a small minority refers to non-artificial toponyms, that is, names of places in the which are likely places of origin in Eastern Europe or places of historic Jewish presence. And only few names refer to the occupation of their first bearers. So all of these names, well, all these categories of names, they are a small minority within these 500 names. Instead, almost every name is German or can be regarded as German, which is also typical for Galician Jewish family names. In Bukovina, artificial names drawn from random German words derived from personal features, ordinary nouns, animals, famous German family names, and names ending on Mann. So far, this could have been expected, and in theory, this aligns with the situation in Galicia. However, in contrast to Galicia, we almost do not find so-called compound names, which were created from two components like Rosenblatt or Sternlieb. Instead, something in Bukovina caught my attention, leading to three superficial and subjective but very important observations. First, almost 50% of names end with R. This is more than in any other area of Galicia. But while in the rest of Galicia we often find the pattern of common German words, supplemented with the ending R, like Blum, R, House, R, and so on, Bukovinian names ending with R do not simply contain an arbitrary German first component, but instead they appear to resemble common family names from southern Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. And it seems unlikely that names like Riegler, Hafner, Heulgräber, and so on were created coincidentally with the mentioned pattern. And extra for Dr. Neger, I have a Huber to show you that this name was also existing among Jews. I didn't find an O'Brien, sorry.
Not yet.
The second observation made me rethink place names and artificial compound names. About 20% of those names whose structure resembled artificially created place names have the ending Inger. Alexander Beider writes in his dictionary about the names in Galicia that this name variation in Galicia is not based on actual place names, but most likely represented a combination of arbitrary nouns and the ending Inger, like before the names with R at the end. So like Teichinger, Schreckinger, and so on. While this artificial naming pattern might be relevant in the rest of Galicia, the situation in Bukovina is different, as a glance at some of the names in question shows. We have names like Meringer, Dettinger, Luttinger, Wolfinger, among others. Also in Bukovina, we could explain some of these names with the same naming pattern, that is, for example, Wolf plus Inger, but not all of the names would make sense. So I double-checked every name and realized that a significant number are actually existing place names, especially in southern Baden-Württemberg, part Germany, and northern Switzerland, like Luttingen, ending in Soffingen. Others were actually existing Christian surnames, which originated in place names several hundred years earlier. The family names Dettinger, Endinger, Luttinger, Meringer, Wolfinger, and so on are all found in the southern Black Forest. Oh yeah. Of course, this could be a coincidence, as some, but not all, of these names can also be found in other regions of southern Germany, and because, as I said, we still could encounter a simple naming pattern, which could still mean that the names, all of these names, were created artificially. But even among the surnames without the ending Inger, names appear, we find names which resemble real places and family names, a significant part of which refer to southern Germany and Switzerland again. Names like Appenzeller, Feldberger, Klingenau, Lenzburger, Hoheim, and Zürcher, and so on. Some of them are big cities, well known, like Zurich, and others are only small villages or hamlets. The third observation regarding family names of Bukovinian Jews is that beside names like Bayer, Körner, and Schneider, which exist all over German-speaking Europe, and especially southern Germany, some names stand out and are clearly limited to a specific linguistic area. Names like Stirler, Fröndlin, Hasen, Fratz, Satron, Zurgilden, among others, could be found almost entirely around Freiburg in the southern Black Forest and neighboring Switzerland in the 18th century. So I'm aware of the problem that my examples here are clearly subjective selection, but all these steps and deliberations can help us in our analysis. Therefore, all these observations lead me to three hypotheses. The first one is, although a majority of names cannot be limited regionally due to their polygenetic character, a part of Bukovinian Jews or family names which had a monogenetic Christian twin, which existed only in southern Germany, and particularly most likely somewhere between Freiburg and Zurich, an area that was part of the Habsburg monarchy known as Further Austria. This accumulation cannot be a coincidence. Second, it is almost impossible that the southern German toponyms and Christian family names give an indication of the actual places of origin of the Jews in Bukovina. We do not know anything about immigration of Swiss Jews to Eastern Europe in that time. And the third one is, we certainly know, because of that, that they were created artificially and not by Jews themselves. This aligns with earlier theories that several Galician Jewish family names were drawn from Austrian dialect, like Orgwaschel or Leinsieder, and are therefore a memorial of the abusive power relation of Austrian officials over Galician Jews. So I could stop here and say, well, this is a proof that Jews were named by Austrian officials, and this is not really new information. But I do not want to finish my analysis here, but rather take us a step further and demonstrate what these names can teach us. So first of all, the Swiss and Black Forest place names in Bukovina don't show a clear pattern, like an alphabetical order of all villages in one district. The arbitrariness of the names indicates that they were not chosen from a map or a book. As you can see, for example, this is a contemporary map of the area. We will find some of the names from Bukovina. We will find them here on the map, but not all of them, especially the tiny villages and hamlets. So this can't be the source. In addition, the knowledge of local Christian surnames and persons indicates clearly the same thing, which is my fourth hypothesis. The Austrian officials responsible for the naming must have had local knowledge of the Black Forest, Switzerland region, and its inhabitants. So my fourth hypothesis is, if we combine all our observations on a map, and I'm really happy that I'm coming to maps now because we had so many nice maps already today, the names will lead us to an epicenter and reveal their origin. So let's get back to the map. The first class of names were toponyms in the vicinity of Bukovina that I mentioned at the beginning. And they seem natural. It seems like they were really places of origin of the Jews in Bukovina. And there are not really many of them. So we don't need them now. Another group were names, famous German family names, German words, and so on, which you will find all over Germany, especially in southern Germany, Austria, and northern Switzerland. So this also doesn't help us a lot. But then I come to the toponyms ending with Inge, especially in the Black Forest and northern Switzerland. So I find place names with this ending, especially in this area. And in addition, we have the other toponyms from the same area, like Appenzeller and so on, not ending on Inge, which are clearly also from the same area. So let's have a look into this area in detail. And you see that a part of these names were derived from tiny hamlets and even fields in a specific area, which you see here. We are therefore searching for something or someone with a connection to this area to explain what happened. So at the beginning, I thought it's maybe connected to the migration within the Habsburg Empire, because many peasants from this area, especially moved to Bukovina, moved to Banat, and so on. But I couldn't find a pattern or something. I couldn't find a real connection. So I checked the biographies of Bukovinian officials. And the most likely candidates who were responsible for the name adoption process in 1787 had no connection to the mentioned area. My assumption was therefore that we had to get back to the first naming wave of 1786, the one that we do not know much about. A little bit we know. So the Habsburg official signing the order to adopt permanent family names in 1786 was Fidelis Ergelet. From 1779 to 1787, he was the court scribe of the military administration in Bukovina. Later, he became a high-ranking and wealthy official in Vienna. But the most important fact in this context is that he was born in Waldshut, on the Rhine, opposite Switzerland. He had a brother in Freiburg and had studied law in Vienna. That means I have no doubt that this very official was the creator of hundreds of Jewish family names in Bukovina in 1786. The assumption, the assumption that Habsburg officials assigned names of their native places is not new, as you can see in this quote from Alexander Beyer. But for the first time, we can prove this theory in detail. The etymological analysis of all these names do not only reveal their creator, but also the process of creation. So we know that 3 years earlier, in 1783, Aglet was the responsible scribe when Bukovinian Jews were registered and classified by a military, military commission. Therefore, he had a complete list of every Jewish family in the district. Then, 3 years later, in 1786, there was no need to travel around and assemble every family again. Instead, he could use the existing name list, most probably without the Jews even being present and without any possibility to interfere. And so he could add new family names of his own personal choice. He assigned family names of people from his hometown, like Appenzeller, Burtscher, Granicher, Gieshaber, Hasenfratz, Inhof, Luttinger, Schneckenburger, and so on, all of which are verifiable in Waldshut and its adjacent villages in the 18th century. Furthermore, he chose names of geographic locations in the vicinity of Waldshut, Lake Schmiedenau, Rohalde, Fahrerhaus, Jüppe, Singen, Niedermatten, Ebnet, Alfen, which are not on the map anymore, but you see, it's like really tiny geographical locations that you only know when you know the area. Then he had some other place names from the broader region, like Lenzburg, Tortnau, Feldberg, Hauenstein, Bondorf, and so on. He also assigned names of persons in Freiburg and Vienna, like Satron, Hinterfahrt, Tölgruber, Leitkamp, and Lobenschuss. In all of this, we cannot see any mockery or derisive names, only German names distinguishable from each other. Sometimes he even used names of celebrities. So Jewish elder Josel Achenwald from Suceava was apparently named after Gottfried Achenwald, one of the founders of modern statistics, whose books were verifiably used by the military administration in Bukovina. And finally, cattle dealer Moises Risbeck from Zalagura appears to be the namesake of writer Johann Caspar Risbeck, who died in Aarau in 1786, the same year, not far from Waldshut. So let me come to my summary. I hope my paper could highlight the importance of analyzing names in the time and place of their creation, as well as their connection to their first bearers. Several names from Bukovina appear in the dictionaries on Galician names, but without the context, their original meaning and intention is totally unclear and can lead to wrong assumptions. For example, the name Wolfinger is explained as a combination of the word wolf and finger, which doesn't make sense after what I said today. Furthermore, I argue that names of Bukovinian and Galician Jews are not only interesting for onomastics, but can be a historical source themselves. Although we lack comprehensive written sources about the first naming wave of 1786, the etymological analysis could answer open questions. Apparently, most of the names were not created by a census commission in 1787, but already by an individual Austrian official in 1786. But the names of Bukovinian Jews can tell us even more than that. The fact that most widows and servants did not bear an own family name shows that the family names were a social category, highlighting inequalities of class and gender. Therefore, they can teach us that it's wrong to say that all Jews in Bukovina or Galicia had adopted family names by 1787. But our findings are not only limited to the field of Jewish history, they teach us something about general history and power relations. We should not handle both fields separately, but understand that both histories are intertwined. The names of Bukovinian Jews help us to look into the minds of Austrian officials of the time of enlightened absolutism. So if we encounter a Jewish family with such a Swiss or Black Forest name, we should think about the possibility that their name is a product of a homesick Austrian official. Thank you very much.